It took 10 years and 22 singles, but Depeche Mode is now the ward in the music called progressive techno-pop. Tonight, the band is appearing in person for an autograph party at a West LA record store. And it has attracted thousands of fans waiting to see their music idols, some who have been lined up since last night.
You could hear the screaming all over the Beverly Center area, a line of teenagers 15 blocks long. Like the swooning over Sinatra, the ecstasy over Elvis, and the fainting over the Fab Four, Depeche Mode is today's hot act.
I haven't seen anything like this before. Girls were crying, boys were hurling themselves at the limousine. Police say now there's maybe 15,000 kids here.
Crowd control problem in West LA tonight.
The private security force could not handle them all, and police had to be called. Some people are calling it a near riot.
Riot police, we are told, have gathered at the Beverly Center.
Police have had to make several arrests, and the band was forced to leave early.
Seems like I haven't seen that since the days of the Beatles.
Reach out, touch faith.
It's not the kind of advertising you can buy, and certainly no record company would pay for.
They delivered the classic record at the right time. I mean, what can you say? Really, it was perfect.
Put out a 12-inch way before the album or the single went to radio, and that became like hugely successful, especially in America. I think it ended up selling like a million copies or something, which was huge. And nowadays, like, it's unheard of. You know,
we had a big production meeting before it started, where the band, myself and Daniel, sat and listened to all of Martin's demos, and it stood out head and shoulders as a perfect track to say, oh, here's Depeche Mode, but not as you know.
It laid a foundation that we had no idea what was about to happen.
Well, it wasn't really a riot, let's get it straight. I mean, there were a lot of people. It's not what I call a riot. There wasn't any violence involved. A couple of people did get hurt, unfortunately, but basically all the fans that were there were very well behaved. It was, Chelsea on a Saturday afternoon. Now that's a riot.
My main recollection of the event was that how lucky we were to get so much publicity for doing nothing, you know. We'd sort of set ourselves to sit there for 4 hours signing records, and of course we were only there for 4 minutes. So not only did we get out of having to do the chore, but we went back to our hotel, switched on the TV, and were on the first item on the news. So we got maximum exposure from it, far more than we'd really anticipated.
You know, I'm happy to say that was my idea, you know, because, you know, I just was thinking about, okay, what can we do to launch this album that's going to take us into mainstream media? We were on every evening news show around in the country the day before the album was in store. Couldn't have been better in my mind.
My favourite Depeche album is probably Violator, because I didn't work on it at all, and I think it's really great.
Well, for me, I think Violator is probably my favourite.
I thought Violator was a standout album, really.
I thought Violator was a great record.
An absolute perfect album.
Violator, obviously.
Violator.
In my eyes, it was the most perfect album they ever did.
Well, I would say the same as Andy, definitely Violator, for a lot of reasons.
It was an amazing album from one end to the other end. Every track on it was incredibly strong. What you pick as singles, who knows, because it's just a great album, and you've got a choice of whatever you want to do. And that album did effectively bring most of the media on board for Depeche Mode.
Until that point, I think we felt like we'd been hitting our heads against a wall. All of our records had sold well, but they'd all sold basically the same amount. It was virtually identical. And then suddenly something, you know, sort of like probably the in-store, tipped us over the edge because of all the national coverage that we got in America.
By that time, and even due to the feedback from the press, from the stateside tour and everything, the band was so in everybody's mind, you know. It was really regarded as a very natural thing, you know. It was for us an obvious thing. It just had to be like this, you know. The only point was really the matter whether you get in the top 10 or top 5 or 5-1 or whatever.
I'm waiting for the night to fall.
That these things seem to happen with Depeche Mode, it's not always down to one specific reason. It's like Flood being involved was a great step, but also from somewhere Martin had just written these just most amazing songs. And to then couple that with somebody who was fast becoming the world's greatest producer, he asked me to say.
And
then, yeah, so it was just, you know, it was just all the stars lining up, I suppose.
You know, we wanted to keep moving on after Music for the Masses, even though that had worked out very well. I think everybody felt that the fresh blood that time had really pushed things along, and we wanted to do that again. And Flood just seemed like a pretty obvious choice.
Well, I think we were reassured that Flood was able to do all things, so he was able to be very hands-on. He could work a sampler, he could use an analog synth, he could also come up with ideas, musical ideas, rhythm ideas, but he and very specific, what I call screwdriver work, or we ended up calling screwdriver work. And at the same time, he could take a back seat overview and be, you know, your Svengali type, this is what you need to do, boys. And so, you know, a good all-round producer.
I'd been working a lot with both very heavily synth programmed type of bands and big rock bands, and I'd felt that there was a way that the two forms of music could actually work together, and in a way Depeche were the perfect band to work with that idea and methodology.
Flood was the first producer who really pushed us.
Everything that he brought to it was new and new to us.
Flood said all our preconceived ideas were basically a load of shit. And if you want to use a guitar, you use a guitar. You know, you should do what sounds good. You shouldn't have rules. And because we had a rule that you must never use the same sound twice. And we were sort of running out of sounds big time. So Flood said, don't worry about that, you know, and it was great, you know. Let me take you on a trip.
Into working on World in My Eyes, we started off refining the demo, and I remember one night we all went out, and well, we went out on quite a lot of nights, but I was talking to Alan and Dave, and they both felt that there was something stopping the track, and that maybe the way that we'd attacked the track was not the best. I was going, okay, fine, I understand what you're saying. And then the next morning, Martin and Fletch came into me and said the identical thing. So I said, okay, let's, as everybody is unhappy with the way it's going, let's just throw it out. Throw out everything that you know about it. And myself and Alan then spent half a day just jamming around different ideas. and the bass line and the came out of that. Track had completely changed by the time that Dave and Martin came back, and I think it was quite a shock. That was the place where the essence for change and the way that we were going to work had happened.
Alan had had a lot of input up to that point, but Flood in tandem with Alan was a great team.